Never messaged you all your life growing up, wanting a man, wanting to be pretty, wanting to be special, wanting to be important. Tearing people up in the world. Tearing people up in the church. Don't love the world's ways. Don't love the world's goods. Love, he didn't say you couldn't have none. He just said don't love. He said, love of the world squeezes out love for the Father. Because see, what God brought you in Jesus ain't got nothing to do with you. And it takes trust in Jesus to live what he's done for you. You can't want it. Once you desire it, you have to believe you received it. You don't get to live in want. You get a desire, but you never stay in it. Because it ain't faith to stay in it. Not faith in Jesus. Practically everything goes on in the world, wanting your own way, wanting everything for yourself, wanting to appear important, has nothing to do with the Father. It just isolates you from him. The world and all is wanting, wanting, wanting. This is mentioned by it. It's on the way out. But whoever does what God wants is set for eternity. And that is to believe and speak and do what Jesus tells you to do. And when you start wanting, you're selfish. You can't forgive. Because you want them to come and treat you special. They shouldn't have did that to me. See, you're wanting. That's why you can't forgive. You can't get the Father's love when you're wanting. No, they shouldn't have done that. See, you're wanting. That's why you see so many marriages get divorced. Because people live in want. When the Lord is your shepherd, you're not wanting. See, when he's your shepherd, he leaves you in the path. He leaves you beside still waters. He leaves you in the green pasture. He restores your soul. He leaves you in the path of the righteous for his name's sake. When he's your shepherd, there is no want because he's leading. And then, yea, though I walk through the valley, now here's you. Then, thank God, we still can trust him and not fear that the Lord is still there with us, even though if we get off track. He'll bring us back. Every time. Every time he'll bring you back. Now you're going to go through some hell. Because you're going to get a whooping. By death. Death always ready to whoop on us. I had a vision years ago. The Lord gave me a vision. In the early 90s. I got most of my visions back then. I get dreams now. And revelation from the Lord. In this vision, I was in this barn. It was like a warehouse, a barn like, and it was one chair right in the middle. And I was sitting in that chair. And on the outside, it was demons and snakes. It was just snakes. And they was tearing that thing up, man, trying to get in there. And Jesus told me. I mean, they was beating on it. They was hitting on it. And man, I was sitting in that chair scared. I thought they were going to get in. And Jesus said, if you'll keep trusting me, no matter how much they pound, they can't get in if you'll keep trusting me. I said, woo! Then I had another vision. See, what he was teaching me was, even though you being attacked, don't have faith in that. They can't get in if you don't give them no place. Even though they're attacking. Don't let that make you start speaking about them. Speak about Jesus. Yes. And then the Lord gave me another vision. Because devils were coming against me all the time. Even down here. Anywhere I went. They hated me. Still do. They just can't do it today. And I went in this vision. And me and Jesus were standing up in this room up in the second heaven. And we were looking in, and in this room, Satan was standing there behind this desk, a table like. And three demons were sitting in chairs at a table. And he said, and the devil, he hit that table. He said, get back down there and get rubber scales. And these three attacks were coming against me in my life. They harassed me. I resist them every day. And after 9 years, all of them left. And I never get lust thoughts. It's so rare, it's a shame. Jesus set me free from that harassing spirit. Took 9 years. Took 9 months with drugs. Took 30 days with cigarettes. Nothing else I've had struggle with. I just had to mature and grow up. And Jesus told his devil. I mean, the devil did.
And the devil said, I don't want to go.
He said, how you doing?
He said, he's always talking about Jesus. He's always talking about the word. He just quotes the word to us all the time. I don't want to go. I want somebody easy.
Then he went to the other devil. And then he went to the third.
I don't want to go.
He shook his head.
I don't want to go. He goes to the Bible and talks about Jesus. He always says he's happy and full of joy. And we can't work. We can't work. Send us to somebody else. We don't want to go.
And Jesus told me when I was feeling weary in well-doing, he told me that I was winning. But the devil was trying to make me feel like that I really wasn't winning. But Jesus showed me in that vision that they was the ones being harassed when you speak in the name every day. They're being tormented every time you stand and have faith in Jesus. Devils are tormented and they're trying to make you think that they are doing something in your life when really you are whooping the daylights out of them.
That's right. Amen.
And he taught me to not grow weary in well-doing. For in due season, I'm going to reap. You going to reap if you faint not. And people give up because of the harassment of devils. When you're supposed to know, keep speaking Jesus. Keep speaking your faith. Keep speaking what his word said every single day. Jesus done won this thing. Quit talking about what the devil's doing and talk about what Jesus did on the cross and what Jesus did to the works of the devil, what Jesus did to sickness and disease, what he did to our sins, what he did to darkness, what he overcame in this world, every fear, every toxin, everything you can think of, Jesus overcame. And the key to living in health and the key to living in victory is believing and speaking and doing what Jesus tell you to do. That's why I walk in love every day. I stay healthy. I don't catch colds and flus. I ain't had that stuff in 20-some years. I don't catch no colds and flus. I see a lot of people hear that, you know, they act like they think I ain't had no symptoms. You understand? No, I fought them. They made them leave. Why? Because Saint, I'm gonna close with this. I'm going to close with this. Abraham, not this, but 2 Corinthians 13, verse 5. We're going to close with this. Because I'm going to leave it. I think the New Living Translation. And I'm going to leave the King James. You want to have 2 Corinthians 13? Okay. You got to amplify it, though. All right, I'll read that. Now, watch. Abraham got a word from God. He got a word from God. And God told him, I've made you a father of many nations. Abraham doubted that for 24 years. What made Abraham start believing he was a father of many nations? What made him start believing? God put it in his mouth to count the stars and count the sand. He made him start saying something to change his thinking. If you don't start saying what Jesus said, just quote him over and over, that stuff will break. It can't handle Jesus' words. It can't handle Jesus is our faith. And Abraham didn't consider his own body now dead, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. He was not weak in faith, saints. He was strong in faith, giving glory to God and being fully persuaded that what God had promised, what God had said, he was able to perform it. You got to know what Jesus said, he is able to perform it. I don't care what nothing look like. The devil be putting smoke screens in our lives trying to make us feel like God ain't what he said in Jesus. He's a liar. And that's why you got to let Jesus teach you how to have patience. How to be able to keep saying the same thing no matter what nothing feel or look like. I am waiting on my God to bless me with my husband, and I ain't having no sex with nobody, and ain't no man going to kiss or touch me for that day. I do. And if you'll stand and speak that, if you don't speak that, he ain't got nothing to work with. He don't have nothing to bring to pass in your life because you're wanting. You're wanting some man to give you attention, look at you, tell you your purity, tell you your beauty. You don't need to know nobody to tell you you're beautiful. You ought to know that yourself. You look at your head that. Jesus made you beautiful when you got saved. You was ugly before then. Every woman in this world ugly until they get saved.
Amen.
Every woman saved is beautiful. And y'all can make them women out there beautiful, but they ain't to God. He said what's beautiful to him is for me. She's beautiful. Sister Marilyn's beautiful. She has a meek and quiet spirit. A gentle spirit. Had it for years. I watched you. I ain't never seen you rowdy and disrespect him. Not one time in 20-some years. I never seen you do it. Not one time I ever seen you disrespect him. Never seen it. And I watched. I watched. I gotta stay with y'all. And he can get in there and get to talk about something, you know, that ain't right. You understand? You just be quiet. Now watch, watch. I'm going to leave y'all with this. In 2 Corinthians, let me just read it in the King James. And then I'll read it in the Amplified. It says, examine yourselves. Whether you be in the faith. Are you really believing you have a word from Jesus that you are speaking and you doing what he tell you in that? See, a lot of people think believing is me just saying I believe. Oh. Mm-mm. Somebody done taught you wrong. Whether you be in the faith, prove your own selves. Know you not your own selves how that Jesus Christ is in you except you be reprobates? Huh? Listen at the Amplified. Examine and test and evaluate your own selves to see whether you are holding to hearing what Jesus said, believing and speaking what Jesus said and doing what he tell you to do every day. He'll tell you, leave that guy alone. You ever heard him tell you that? Leave him alone. You should be like that. He told me when in 88, he said, don't you date nobody. I never dated. He said, don't go to none of them fellowships and functions. I never went to one. He said, come on here and come in here with me and worship me. And I pray 4 hours a day. 2 in English and 2 in tongue. Every day, I pray 2 hours every day on my knees for over 2 years. And I didn't, and this, I know this is a little deep for some of y'all. But I didn't watch TV for 6.5 years. Maybe a ball game Sunday afternoon for church, and then I never missed church my whole Christian walk. I ain't never missed church. I ain't never been no preaching engagement. Missed church for a ball game? Oh, Lord. I missed 2 Super Bowls the first 2 years and didn't even watch it and could have. And told Jesus I wanted to show him that I loved him more. 3rd year, Dallas was playing and he knew I wanted to watch it. And he said, you can tape it. He's taught me that nothing in this world ruled me. I don't have no favorite shows on nothing on TV. I watch news and watch ball games with ESPN or something, or Discover, you know, Science or something. But I'm telling you, I don't watch none of them shows. Desperate Wives. No, give me some Holy Wives. I don't want to watch none desperate. They're not going to pollute my mind with that, man. All them killings and all that, man. And people they got part of the world. They wonder why this fake stuff don't work right. You're mixing it with the world. There's nothing wrong with you going to watch a movie or something. But I can count on three fingers. I can count on one hand how many times I've been in a movie in 23 and a half years. And that was with my son. And then we had to get up, walk out of one of them. Ain't a G movie. Girl had her underclothes on with a boy. I said, oh no, come on, son, come on, that's it.
Amen.
What about having to give me my money back? I won't let my son hang around people drinking and stuff. I said, no, come on, we gone. See you, mama. I told him that you don't hang around that. For family or nobody. A lot of y'all, your kid grew up hanging around your family drinking. And everybody ain't grew up drinking. Because you let them believe that they could hang around and be all right. He told me to separate myself from among them, touch not the unclean thing. He would receive me. He did say that, Pastor Hill. He did say that. He said, come out from among them. Be separate, said the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. That's the first thing Jesus started teaching me, was to separate myself from what could pause in me and stop me from walking with him right. I cut everything loose. Everything. And the worst thing I did was got cable so I could watch NBA basketball games. I'd probably be further with God if I hadn't done that. Just tell the truth on myself. Examine, test, evaluate your own self to see whether you are holding to your faith and showing the proper fruits of it. That's your actions. Are you showing the proper fruits? Is he coming through every day? Do you see Jesus? You forgiving? You're walking in love all the time, every day, in every situation? Or are you bothered about something, upset about something that you kept? It's not wrong to get upset. Be angry and don't get out of faith in his love and what he told you to do. Test and prove yourselves, not Christ. Do you not yourselves realize and know thoroughly that an ever-increasing experience that Jesus Christ is in you, unless you are counterfeits, disapproved, on trial, and rejected? You're supposed to examine your faith. You're supposed to examine your faith in anything. Whether Christ is really working in you. You're supposed to just be going along, taking every punch and blowing everything, cut up. Go see the Lord come through. Real Bible faith is hearing him, speaking it. No, you don't have to get back where you're speaking. Speak it. Believe he can do it, and then get it in your mouth. And then just do what he tell you every day. Amen. You got to make this thing work. Jesus make it work. But you're going to have to get it in your mouth, what he said, what he taught, what he did. You're going to have to speak that thing out of your mouth every day. And then you're going to do what he tell you to do. He says, stop this, you got to stop. Don't go over there, don't go over there. Do this, do this. Don't do this, don't do that. I do what he say all the time. Josh was giving me a testimony. We was at lunch today. Josh gave me a testimony, and he said, Dad, I remember the first time, man, I met you. He was working at a rainforest, wasn't it? He was working at a rainforest, and then I went in there and said, I'd eat lunch. And so you weren't even waiting on me. Billy was waiting on me, wasn't it? And but Josh came over to the table while Billy was waiting on me. And Josh came over to the table, and when he walked over to me, he said, Dad, this is the first time I met you. You said, how much are you short on your rent? Because I live by Jesus every day. I've been helping folks like this. I mean hundreds of thousands of times the Lord done told me exactly what how to help people. I got to have money.
Amen.
I got to have money. I got to have money. He uses me to help people.
Amen.
All the time. It never ends. Amen. I mean, I need to be somewhere. He said they need help. That's how he want to do all of us. The just shall live by Jesus. No, quit saying faith and you don't know what it means. We live by who Jesus is. We live by what Jesus did, by hearing his word, speaking it out of our mouths, and then doing what he tells us to do. Examine yourself. Is this always working in your life? Because if it ain't, you're doing something wrong. You're not believing and speaking and doing what he tells you to do. Bow your heads. Father, thank you. Y'all know I get two shots at you. I take a little bit of it. Amen. Y'all know how I am. And you've always loved me. I'm glad. Thank you, Lord. Father, if there's someone here today that needs your love, need a touch from you, Lord, don't let them leave. Don't let them leave. Oh, I pray your love will draw them, Father. They'll get touched, and you'll confirm your word. In Jesus' name. If you're here today, just keep your head bowed. You said, Pastor Kez,